Good evening and welcome to What Saith the Scripture. My name is Christian Franklin.
And I'm Brant Stubblefield.
And we are very excited tonight because we are continuing on the topic of the kingdom of God. But before we get started, we really want to say a couple things. First off, we want to thank you all for the support, the overwhelming support, the messages. I know I've received a lot of good messages. I know yes. Brant here has too, especially from brethren and from non-members too. It's really interesting that we've been able to come up with something very, you know, impactful in just a short amount of time. And some of the numbers we want to kind of go off tonight about the page likes, we've reached over 600 page likes. The whole page itself has reached over 12,000 views, has reached almost 15,000 people. And so, I mean, it's just astonishing how the Lord is working, you know, in such really good ways, especially with the way that we can utilize this time, especially with the whole COVID-19 pandemic, you know, how people, you know, they have more time, but they all, the more time they have, the more time they have to think about things, especially things about concerning the Word of God. And so this is what we try to do here is we try to help to seek and save those that which are lost, Luke chapter 19 and verse 10. And to do that, we have to dig deep into the Word. The seed is the Word, Luke chapter 8 and verse 11. And so as we get started, I'm just really just want to say a big thank you to all those who've been supporting us.
And we continue to make that promise to echo Peter's statement in 1 Peter 4 that if any man speak, let him speak as of the oracles of God. And so Christian and I are going to try our very dead level best to always speak and preach those things that are found written in the Scripture. We're not here to chase hobbies. We're not here with an agenda. There's no financial request being made on this program. In fact, this program is made free of charge and sponsored by your friends and brethren at the Deer Creek Church of Christ that meets at 6225 Northwest 178th here in Edmond, Oklahoma. We are meeting each Lord's Day at 10:30, even through the COVID-19 quote crisis. However, we want to make sure you understand we're meeting in the parking lot. We've talked to the authorities that be, and we're doing things in a way that's safe and to also allow us to still fulfill the Scripture's request. So if you're out and about this next Lord's Day, feel free to join us again at 6225 Northwest 178th Street, Edmond, Oklahoma, 10:30 a.m. And we'll also have, worship right here in the parking lot and be pleasing unto God.
Amen.
Something else I want to mention tonight as we begin, let's pause for a moment. And Christian, would you lead us in prayer and ask God to bless our study and to bless everyone who's listening this evening?
Amen. Let's go. Heavenly Father, we come to you now, and Father, we are so thankful for all the many wonderful blessings you have given us, Father, not just physical, but also spiritual blessings, Father. Father, as we continue tonight, Father, let us study intensely from your word, Father. Let us draw conclusions specifically from what you have told us, Father. Let us be strong. Let us be diligent in your word, Father. Mm-hmm. And Father, let us edify one another. Let us encourage one another to really look at what you are saying on topics instead of what man is saying on topics. And so, Father, we thank you so much for your Son who died on that cross, and it's in your Son's holy and precious name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. And there'll be a few references. Since this is part two of a fascinating subject, the kingdom of God or kingdom of heaven, there will be a few references tonight that we have utilized both times because those passages are key verses that tie in core issues to understanding this vital subject, the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven. We stated last week that both John the Baptizer and Jesus himself announced emphatically the kingdom was at hand and it was coming. And in Matthew 3:2 and in Mark chapter 1:14 through 16, again, both John and Jesus, repent ye for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And Jesus comes preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. And this is a great subject because when we start looking at the Old Testament prophets tonight, these Old Testament prophets, in summation, were pointing to, no doubt, the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ and the spiritual nature and establishment of his holy and divine kingdom. Okay, technology is great, but it does have its problems. Nemo stated that, you know, because of the COVID-19, so many sermons and religious materials being broadcast on Facebook, amongst other types of broadcast, that sometimes there's just not enough infrastructure and resources for all that to go around. So ultimately, we apologize for that, but it's beyond our control. We're back. We're live. The subject is the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. It's part two. And the reason we chose these subjects, Matthew chapter 24, Are we living in the last days? The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. Because of the times in which we live under the COVID-19 crisis, people are asking these questions. And a lot of religious people,
right,
sometimes take advantage of people's emotions and try to sensationalize the gospel. And we're not really wanting to do that. We want to go back to the Bible and see what God has to say about these timely subjects.
Amen. And you know, and that's what we aim to do. And we want to reiterate that point over and over and over again. We don't want to put personal opinion into it or maybe an I think statement. We just want to see what God's word says on the subject.
And it's difficult, but as we go back to the Bible and we return to that ancient plea of speaking where the Bible speaks, 1 Peter chapter 4, and remaining silent, wherein it is silent, that's our endeavor, that's our hope, and we hope you have that goal too. If you're live with us this evening, feel free to comment, to text, or even make a phone call to us, 405-756-0880. We are giving away, as we mentioned, every week free New Testaments to anyone who would like to have one. We have a book, Muscle and the Shovel, that Christian is willing to give out free of charge. So make sure you write or call us this evening with your questions. We're glad you joined us again. I don't really know what you've heard and what you haven't heard, but let's just get right down to it. The kingdom of God is what's under discussion this evening. Now, last time we was on, I had several people email me and message me after. I haven't even responded to every detailed question because they were very complex. Several people asked this question. If we're going to study about how the old prophets look forward in the telescope of time to the coming of the kingdom, how do we know that those prophets were actually looking down to the kingdom, and how do we know that those New Testament authors correctly understood that? In other words, a little bit of teaching about what is prophecy. Well, prophecy in the scripture, number one, always and without exception is inclusive of the divine element. That's a true prophet. There are false prophets. 1 John 4:1 warns us against those. But a true prophet, a spokesman on behalf of God, always had the element of miraculous. And so there's a divine element. We're not talking about a set of casual predictions that anybody could make about the future. You know, I'd predict this would happen, or I would predict this would happen. You're already starting with things that you observe and see,
right,
and then you're making casual predictions in extension of those things. That's not what we're talking about, prophecy. Prophecy actually is not even having the circumstances or the premise, drawing that from God himself and he, the Holy Spirit, putting those words into the mouth of the prophet or the mind of the prophet. And even Ephesians chapter 3, verse 5 would be a good definition of that, that the things revealed, that mystery were revealed by the Holy Spirit unto the apostles and the prophets. And another point about prophecy, Christian, that I think is worth repeating here, is that prophecy has an element of preparation involved in it. So if we were to look at the totality of Old Testament prophecy, we know that there was a purpose and a connection overall to that teaching. While many small, minute points were given, the ultimate reason that Old Testament prophets existed was to look forward to that messianic deliverance and the kingdom that would reign simultaneously with Jesus, spiritual in nature. Hebrews 1, 1 and 2, God who at sundry times and at diverse manners in times past spoke unto the fathers by the prophets, but now hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Last days, last dispensation, Christian era. So now God speaks to us through his Son. Well, then all these old prophets, Christian, what are some of the things that they are declaring concerning the kingdom and concerning Christ?
Well, first off, I mean, there's a divine being. There's an overarching being that is going to be ahead of this kingdom. The tabernacle of David is going to be rebuilt. There's a lot of, it's interesting reading about the lineage of Christ, especially in Matthew. You see the connections being made there, especially with the Old Testament prophets, both major and minor prophets. And a distinction I like to make with the major and minor prophets is that even though the minor prophets, they're not necessarily minor in, you know, importance. That's not what we're trying to say. But the content, the amount of content is much smaller, but very, very kingdom focused. It's laser focused on what is going to come, what the kingdom that is at hand, what is going to happen. So we have to remember that also with these prophets, these Old Testament prophets, that these prophecies will be fulfilled. Yes. Later on in the New Testament. So we want to reiterate too that we're not talking about a futuristic, post-apocalyptic, premillennialistic view per se. We want to talk about what the Word is specifically telling us now about the kingdom that we are supposed to be in right now.
Yeah, and in fact, when Jesus came preaching the gospel of the kingdom, Mark chapter 1, 14 through 16, it states in that passage the time of being at hand, the things were being fulfilled that the prophets had declared. And so I just want to point out that although there were many details that the prophets collected in the Old Testament from the revelation of God and that spoke about these inspired men, it is the case that the summation of the prophets is always towards the cross, towards the burial, towards the resurrection, and towards the messianic kingdom of which, spiritual in nature, Christ himself would reign over as the Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9:6, the Deliverer, Matthew 1 and 21. And the reason we know this is because when we look at the scripture and passages, let's look at Acts 26:22. Acts 26:22, the Bible reads, "Having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day witnessing both the small and the great, saying none other of those things which the prophets and Moses say should come, that Christ should suffer and he should be the first and should rise from the dead and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles." And there's so many passages I looked at earlier. 1 Peter chapter 1, that the angels declared to look into the things concerning salvation that the prophets had written. But the prophets wrote these things under the hand and under the guidance of God. And these divine, miraculous prophecies that were declared by these holy men of God, they were guided by the Holy Spirit, Ephesians 3:5. And there's undoubtedly a summation of truth. And that truth is Jesus is coming. The first time, you stated earlier, you quoted Luke 19 and 10, he's coming to seek and save the lost, Luke 19 and 10, God in the flesh, John 1:14, he's coming to fulfill the Father's divine plan, Ephesians 3:10 and Romans 5:8, that sinners would be saved, and he's coming not only to bring about his blood offering on the cross to save sinners, but he's also going through that same blood to purchase and to establish a blood-bought kingdom that is going to change this world forever. Now this world, this earth's not going to be here forever.
No.
When I say he's changing the world, I'm talking about the world as far as humanity. He's changing the populace of humanity. Sinners now, Jew and Gentiles, having obeyed the gospel, are going to be privileged through the blood of Jesus to have their sins washed away and enter into this wonderful kingdom, spiritual in nature. Amen. Christian, how do we know that the kingdom is not worldly like some of the older Jewish generations had thought? How do we know the kingdom is not of this world?
Well, Jesus even said to Pilate himself in John chapter 18, verse 36, that this kingdom is a spiritual kingdom. It is not of this earth. And so we have to keep that in mind. So to be a part of a spiritual kingdom, I mean, we would have to follow what the king orders or commands. And so what does that say for Christians today? We follow Christ, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. And so we really need to be considering, especially for those viewers out there who maybe are not a part of this kingdom, the part of the church, we really want to reiterate that we're going to be going over some things that solidify, that validate, that these things that we are reading from are true. Even Jesus said himself, I believe in Luke chapter 24, he's talking about the prophets and Moses and all these things he solidified, he validated himself. So these are just not some things like 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20 through 21, that's not private interpretation of these men, but they were directly inspired, divinely inspired by the Holy Spirit to write these things that we have. So we really have to take this into account of what the Word is really saying about the kingdom. We need to make sure that we are
holy men of God spake, as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. And like that verse you quoted earlier, alluded to in Luke 24, wherein Jesus gives the three departments of the old law.
Right.
The Jewish people divided that into three compartments, Jesus being, of course, a most eloquent and the only sinless Jew to ever live. He understood that completely when he said the law, the prophets, and the psalms. That's how they divided that literature. And all three of those have the summation of one truth. They're pointing conclusively to those fundamental facts that Paul alluded to in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, the death, the burial, and the resurrection, according to the scripture of Jesus Christ. And that's why you're going to see a continuity of this thread that runs all throughout the Old and New Testament. And here's why we bring this up. Because when we're dealing with all this kingdom talk, so many people view the kingdom as future, physical, with geographical land promises from Jerusalem, from the city of David, right? And there's going to be a resurrection of this masses of people with the second opportunity, the rapture, premillennialism. I mean, there's all kinds of things that words we could throw out that would grab the attention of people that they've heard all their lives.
Right.
But folks, let's don't make the same mistake the Jewish people made. Prophecies, remember, are not casual predictions. They have a divine element. We've already studied that. Prophecies are miraculous in nature. Prophecy being a spiritual gift, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 mentions, and ultimately chapter 13 says they would end up ceasing when the revelation of God's will ceased. We have all the revelation of God's will that we're ever going to have, folks. So yeah. Prophecy are not casual predictions. They're miraculous in scope. But also prophecies had that very, very woven thread, again, of continuity that in summation points to the death, burial, and resurrection, and to the establishment of a spiritual kingdom. So I refer to that point as preparatory. Mm. Prophecies are preparatory. What do you mean? Because they would help to instruct people. Prophecy is not just about predicting the future. It's teaching. It's inspired teaching that begins to set forth a foundation to change people. Because the definition of the kingdom, we stated the other evening, remember, is that it is the throne or the rule of God in our hearts and closely connected to that, requiring a translated or changed state. That's why the main message of Jesus and John the Baptist was repent. Here's the main message. Don't worry about some physical land of Israel. Don't worry about Jesus coming back to this earth. That's beyond the scripture. That's not written in scripture. We need to be concerned about repentance and entrance into the kingdom, which was spiritual in scope. In fact, all the prophets were declaring the spiritual kingdom. And that's what I want to see before we dig into Isaiah 2 tonight, to have that in our mind, because if we don't understand how prophecies work, we're going to be at a disadvantage as to the interpretation of the passage.
Right.
And I remember what an older preacher told me years ago, Christian. Mm. You know, sometimes when you're roofing a house or you're driving a nail in, sometimes you miss the nail and hit your thumb. You have a big, you know, I've had that happen. Mm. Sometimes, though, you hit the nail just right, and on that one strike, it just drives it. Well, this old preacher hit the nail on the head on this occasion. And he said the only absolute inspired interpretation and an infallible interpretation of the text is when a New Testament apostle, inspired of the Spirit, interprets an Old Testament prophecy. Mm. So when we have, for example, recorded in Matthew chapter 1 concerning the virgin birth, what Isaiah had prophesied, chapter 7, verse 14, we have absolute evidence that the Spirit has interpreted the prophecy for us. We need not have any controversy on those texts.
Right.
So ultimately, we're going to find out this evening that Isaiah 2, through Joel 2 and Acts 2, that the apostles, Christ, other inspired men, have concluded that that text is undoubtedly in reference to the establishment of a spiritual kingdom. So with all that said, I think it's time. Do you have Isaiah 2 open?
Yeah. Isaiah chapter 2, starting in verse 2. It says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains."
Now, we already have discussed this about three lessons ago, but again, we have new viewers. So some of this, you have to have some repetition in, folks, for two reasons. We learn by repetition. Repetition, 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 the mother of all learning. Secondly, when you're putting all these dots together, if you miss a few, it's going to be difficult to grasp the overall meaning.
Right.
So when people see the phrase last days, Christian, so many of them assume immediately we're talking about some TV evangelist with lots of hype and sensationalism trying to warn people that, you know, it's almost here, a few months, maybe a few years, and he's about to be here.
Right.
Well, first of all, no one even knows when Jesus is coming back. We studied that earlier too, remember?
Right.
No man knoweth the day nor the hour when Jesus shall return.
It's the world's greatest secret, Matthew 24, 36.
And in the flesh, he didn't even know when he was coming.
No.
He said, "My Father only, no, not even the angels." So the last days is not a reference to the last few weeks, months, and years. It's just a reference to the last dispensation, the last religious period of time that God hath set, like Hebrews 1 talked about. In latter days and former times and in various ways, God has spoken. He's always spoken, but he's changed over the course of time the manners and the times and the covenants by which he's spoken.
Mm.
Today he speaks to us not by ongoing prophecies. He speaks to us through his Son and the prophets that declare things ultimately culminated in either the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ or the establishment of his kingdom. There's really only one last prophecy remaining, and that is the second advent of Jesus Christ. Most prophecies in the Bible, folks, have already been fulfilled.
Amen.
And that's why when you read Matthew and when you read Peter and Paul, and they quote from the Old Testament, and when they say that so-and-so wrote, Isaiah wrote, and it hath been fulfilled. They're talking about it being fulfilled the time they spoke it. They're making application to it. So when we read Isaiah 2, when it says in the last days, see, this is where people make a mistake. They assume, okay, well, it's a time frame. And right at the very, very end, things are going to happen. and Christ eventually is going to come back and reign from Jerusalem 1,000 years physically. The only problem is there's not one verse in the entire New Testament that tells us Jesus is coming back to this earth. What's going to happen to the earth, Christian?
Well, it's going to burn up.
Burn up?
Yeah.
Wow. 2 Peter 3:10, I mean, that's
fervent
plain.
Fervent heat, yeah.
Fervent heat. Yeah. 2 Peter 3:10, I do know a few people running around. They think that we're going to live in this little utopia, you know, forever. We're going to be here forever in this little blissful, recreated state. But that's not the case. 2 Peter 3:10, this earth and the works therein shall be burned up. Folks, we're moving on beyond this old earth. We're moving to a place of glory if we're saved, if we're Christians, and if we're in that spiritual kingdom.
Amen.
But I just thought we started Isaiah 2 tonight. We just have to make it plain that the last days is a phrase spoken of the New Testament as the Christian era. And if you're home, you're not convinced yet, take these scriptures down and read them at home. Hebrews 1, 1 and 2. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. There's many others, but those two should suffice to at least place in your mind the teaching that the last days were already in existence when the New Testament was being penned.
Amen. And I was thinking too, you know, when the flood came, you know, Noah and Sodom and Gomorrah, they were going about their normal day. So we don't know exactly when Christ is going to come back. We don't know that, you know, today is the last day. We just don't know. I mean, life will go on as...
That was the comparison that he had made in Matthew 24. They were eating and drinking in the days of Noah. So shall it be when Christ comes. People will be carrying on their normal lives. But when that trumpet of God sounds, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 14 through 16, when the dead in Christ rise and those series of end time events occur so quickly and sudden that no man hath time to prepare his house. The key is not to worry about the when. The key is to be concerned that we need to be right with God,
Amen.
Christian. This
Amen.
Is the most important thing that anybody could discuss this evening is, am I right with God? Have I contacted that precious blood of Jesus? Folks, couldn't we all agree tonight that without the blood of Jesus that we're not saved? I would say most people, especially in the South, where we do most of our teaching and preaching, in the Southern culture of the United States of America, most people have been taught emphatically and correctly that salvation is through and by the basis of that salvation, the remedy for our sin, is through the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
But many don't realize that same blood of Jesus that gave us the remission of sins, Hebrews 9:22, Matthew 26:28, that it also bought the church or the kingdom.
Acts 20:28.
That's why the kingdom is important and essential. It's not because some preacher wants you to come into a building a few times a week. The reason the kingdom is essential, valuable, and important is because it's directly connected to the blood of Jesus. Wouldn't we agree anything connected to the blood is both valuable and essential?
Amen.
The value of an item is directly correlated to the price that was paid for it. The price that was paid for the church or the kingdom is of the highest rank and order.
Amen.
So let's keep reading in Isaiah 2. But there's a prophecy that in the last days, the house of the Lord, the kingdom, the church, all synonymous words, it's going to be established. And keep reading.
Okay. So in verse 2, and it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow unto it.
That's beautiful because in the Old Testament, although God had a law for the Gentiles, undoubtedly, there was a sanctified and holy people that were under the Ten Commandments written on two tablets of stones, the Jewish people. Now, these people, this sacred people, the reason God chose them was not because he did not have favor to other people. Because you read the book of Jonah, you'll know that.
Right.
The reason that God had so much invested in Israel was because through Israel, there would come this deliverer to the people that would not only through his atoning blood save Israel, possibly, those that believed in him and came to him in their faith, but he would save all men, Jew and Gentile alike, Romans chapter 1, verse 16. So when we're preaching tonight from the prophecy of Isaiah, which ultimately will be fulfilled again, Joel 2 and in Acts 2, when we wrap all of those together, we'll see the conclusive power here of this text, that the kingdom is established in the last days. Well, the last days, a reference to from the time that Pentecost began, the day of Pentecost, when the church began, all throughout the New Testament period. And we know here from this text that all nations are going to flow into it. You mean more than Israel is going to flow into this kingdom?
It's been open, yeah.
Remember when Jesus taught the limited commission, Christian?
Mm.
The limited commission, the great commission. Scholars sometimes scholars don't talk about the first commission as much as the latter commission. The first commission, Jesus trained his people to take the teaching to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The Great Commission, great in its scope, more sizable in its scope, would still begin in Jerusalem, Luke 24, 44 through 49, but it would have lasting, it would go all over the globe and be inclusive of the Gentiles, Romans 1, 16, Colossians 1 and 23. And so when we read that phrase, all nations shall flow into it, can you think of a Great Commission passage that has that verbiage in it, Matthew, the 28th chapter?
See, in Matthew chapter 28, and I was even thinking Mark chapter 16, verse 15, says, go ye therefore into all nations, preach the gospel to every creature. And so that's the beauty of it. It's not exclusive.
That's right.
This gospel is open to all, but it's up to us. It's up to the person and then the conviction of their heart. We talk about the heart up here.
Yes.
To obey the gospel.
All the world, Mark 16, all nations, Matthew 28. And so I want you to see, as we go through Isaiah 2, the key points of this prophecy ultimately and just emphatically point to the beginning of the day of Pentecost when, by the way, all of these Jewish men on the day of Pentecost were gathered under the providence of God to be there for that feast. Mm. They had to be there if they were faithful. By the way,
Deuteronomy 16:16.
We just studied that. Yeah. And if they were not faithful, look what they had missed out on. Mm. You see that? When you're not faithful to God, you miss out on blessings.
Right.
The faithful Jews that were there to worship and observe this feast, they're there. They get to hear the first sermon after resurrected Jesus by an inspired man, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit. And all of these nations are present. That is, Jews that had held foreign citizenship in various nations had come home to observe this feast. Now, but according to Acts chapter 1, the gospel is going to begin here in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost part of the world. By Colossians 1:23, all nations had heard the gospel. Mm. So Isaiah says that in the last days, the day from Pentecost onward, that the gospel is going to go forth, the teaching is going to go forth, the house of the Lord is going to be established, and all nations shall flow into it. The church of Christ, the kingdom of God, is an inclusive kingdom.
Amen.
It is inclusive of every nation on earth. Doesn't matter what tribe, dialect, tongue, doesn't matter size, stature, social, economic status, level of education. If one is of accountable age and can count the cost and through repentance and baptism come into the kingdom, of course he obviously has to believe.
Sure.
Repent and come into the kingdom, he's going to contact the blood of Jesus and he's going to be saved.
Amen.
Of course, we know we come into the kingdom in that ultimate act of baptism, and we'll discuss that toward the end of the broadcast. But let's keep reading in Isaiah 2 and find some more nuggets here in the text.
So continuing in verse 3, and many people shall go and say, come ye, and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem.
A king has to have citizens. He has to have a law, and he has to have a domain. Mm. Well, Luke 17, 20 and 21 tells us that the kingdom of God is within us. It's not a geographic, it's not bounds and meets, remember?
Right.
It's not something that you can take a surveyor and say, all right, you tell us exactly where the kingdom starts and where it ends. Well, you can't measure it that way because the kingdom of God is within you if you are within the kingdom.
Amen.
If you are within the kingdom of God is within you because it's the rule of God in your heart. Takes a changed man. That's why the concept of repentance is always taught by John and Jesus. So here we are in Isaiah 2. Christian just keeps bringing these things out for us in the text. The last days, we've discussed that. The last era when the church begins all the way through the end of this age. And he's also discussed the fact the mountain of the Lord's house is going to be established. All nations are going to flow into it. Matthew 28, that's the Great Commission. And now we have it that we're going to learn of his ways. Christianity is a taught religion.
Amen.
Now, you know, let's just be frank about it. There are a lot of different religious groups that hold on to various things. I mean, some are a better felt than told.
Sure.
There's nothing wrong with emotion.
Right.
I mean, I even get pretty passionate when I preach. That's just my style, my personality. But it doesn't matter how passionate a person is. Mm. If they're wrong, they're wrong. You can be passionate and be wrong, right?
Right.
But I also know that, some people get so carried away with religion. I mean, that they can just get carried away into complete emotional hype. Mm. I've seen it on TV. People just almost are beside themselves. And they say, oh, I just feel so good. Now, wait a minute, folks. Feelings can deceive us.
Mm.
And just because you feel something does not mean it's right. There's a lot of times, I mean, I'm a preacher. I've married people. Oh, they felt like they were just so in love. You know what I mean? And they didn't even get to the point of being married because all of a sudden then their feelings changed. Feelings change.
Right.
And the only thing constant in this world actually is Jesus Christ, that is the Godhead, and his divine and holy message, Hebrews 13 and 8. All other things we have to be careful about, that those things do not mess and disturb with our mind.
Amen. And I was even thinking, you know, the heart, sometimes we always point here with the heart, and I know that you let me know that the heart's really up here. You know, like we have to have intellect.
Right.
We have to have reasoning. And so with this heart leading us, especially with these religious, you know, institutions, and no ill will towards them, but what happens is their heart, right, starts leading them. But like you said, the heart and emotions can be deceptive. I think about Jeremiah chapter 17, verse
right.
9. It says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Think about Proverbs chapter 4, and verse 23. It says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life.
I mean, sure.
Don't get me wrong, the heart is important. We must have, there has to be emotion, there has to be passion and zeal for the kingdom, for the church. But at the same time, we have to have intellect, we have to have reasoning, we have to have the word and a good study and understanding of the word and what God is telling us before we get carried away with emotions. And so that's kind of, you know, mm-hmm. that can possibly be a part of the reason why we get so many obscured views on, you know, the kingdom and like the Old Testament prophecies and so forth, because instead of actually doing the diligent work of studying the word, the heart, the emotions, and just people around us too can just influence our
instinct. Yeah, if we're not, exactly right. If we're not careful, we will interpret the prophecies by what we already believe in our religion, or we'll interpret them by our emotions or our thoughts that are disturbed, especially in times of crisis. That's
right.
Why when Isaiah says you're going to be taught of the Lord, Christianity is a taught religion. And that means when Jesus told the soon-to-be apostles, I always say that because they were called to be apostles, they had met the qualifications, but folks, until the baptism of the Holy Ghost set upon them in Acts 2:1, they were not official. So Jesus has instructed the apostles, and these soon-to-be apostles, these men, he says, go out and preach the gospel. Matthew 28, teaching all nations, baptizing them. But you don't baptize anybody unless they're taught.
Amen.
That's why when someone says, well, I've already been baptized, I ask you tonight to listen to the text, because you have to be taught right to be baptized correctly. If you're not taught correctly, you will have confusion on baptism or the kingdom or anything. And so teaching is so vitally important, and that's why tonight you'll notice we're not really interested in a bunch of smoke and mirrors. You know, I saw one place that, you know, the preacher wrote a Harley Davidson on the stage, shaved his head, they had so many people in attendance. I'm not interested in all that junk. What we want to do is thoroughly investigate the Bible and find as many people who are honest and sincere that want to have that same endeavor and build upon that.
Amen.
That's what our plea is, to go back to the Bible, let's look into this text, and let's keep going. But now we know for sure that this prophecy is pointing to something being built in the last days. All nations are going to flow into it, and it's going to be a religion. It's going to be a building of God that is taught and upheld by the modem of teaching.
So let's go on in verse 4. And he shall judge among the nations and shall rebuke many people, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore.
Now that's an interesting text, because see, a lot of people who are premillennialists, they think this passage is still not fulfilled because they believe that those things are physically going to occur.
Right.
The mistake they're making is assuming that that last part of the passage is literal. Many prophets, folks, prophesied and received the miraculous divine element of prophecy from God, the Holy Spirit, through figures, types, and allegories and so forth to point to and to foreshadow something in a very verbose, figurative way with literature that sometimes is referred to as apocalyptic. Now, this particular piece is simply emphasizing the peace that would be in the kingdom, the peace in the kingdom, that there would be a removal of a warlike mentality, and there would be a coming together of all nations like never before. What other institution and religion known to man all over the globe, other than Christianity and that beautiful kingdom, has allowed men from every tribe, tongue, and dialect to come into complete commonality with the same bond and tie? There is not another thing on earth.
No. There's not.
And by thing, we have no disrespect. It's a lack of words, but I mean, we're talking about the blood-bought church, the blood-bought kingdom. And so, interestingly enough, Isaiah 9:6, Jesus himself is described by the prophet as the Prince of Peace. Mm. Interestingly enough, on the Pentecost pointers, Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes, those eight that point to what life is going to be like in the upcoming kingdom, did Jesus himself not say, blessed are the peacemakers?
Mm.
Who are going to be the peacemakers? I don't believe that's a reference to just a moral quality. We're not talking about an arbiter between two people trying to finalize a business deal or decide who's right and who's wrong. Blessed are the peacemakers, in my understanding of the text, is a reference back to all these old prophets, and what Jesus is describing is how life is going to be in the upcoming kingdom. Blessed, happy are those people who are going to enter into the kingdom because they're going to be the world's greatest peacemakers.
Amen.
Why? Because they're going to bring people together.
Yeah, and I was thinking real fast, and I mean interrupt
you,
but
okay.
In Romans chapter 12, verse 18, even the Apostle Paul writes, if it be possible, as much as life in you, live peaceably with all men.
That's right.
I mean, it doesn't get any more cut and dry than that. We have to be able to live peaceably, and that's with all men too. And we understand that sometimes, you know, in the church that we have the brethren, we, you know, Matthew chapter 12, verse 50, you know, who have done the will of the Lord and,
right.
You know, who have obeyed the gospel. But that means to the whole world, we're not supposed to be a war-minded, you know, mentally prepared for battle kind of people. We are peacemakers, but we will fight for the word of God, but
right.
Being peaceful.
That's different.
Right.
Fighting the good fight of faith is required, and the church in that sense is militant as we defend the gospel, Paul said in Philippians chapter 1, and as we again fight the good fight of faith, Paul said. But what you're talking about, that peace that comes from the blood of Jesus,
Amen.
And you're exactly right. I thought of Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 13 and 14. Listen to this. But now in Christ Jesus, who ye were sometimes were afar off, are made nigh by the blood of Christ. This is in reference to the Gentiles.
Mm.
They were once afar off. They were not nigh to the blood of Christ. They were alienated to the commonwealth. But notice what he says in verse 14. For he is our peace, as Jesus. He is our peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, Matthew chapter 5. Why? Because they're going to live and conduct themselves in such a way in the kingdom. Not only are they going to be peaceful men morally, Romans chapter 12, but they're going to be able to spread the gospel all over land and sea. Mm-hmm. All nations are going to flow into it. All of the old methodologies of a warlike mentality physically are going to subside. And this reigning spiritual kingdom that has nothing to do with physical boundaries, the real war is now going to be fought between good and evil.
Amen.
And the people of God are going to lead in the fight. But we're not going to take up swords. We're not going to take up other instruments of war. We're going to take up one instrument, Christian. One instrument as our offensive weapon. And that, according to Ephesians 6 and 17, is the sword of the Spirit. Y'all with me tonight? The sword of the Spirit. How many of you out there watching are good? Have you had some practice with the sword? Ephesians 6, 17 says the sword of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit yields his influence through the instrumentality of the Word of God, the sword. So you've got to be good using the sword so that you can teach and defend the gospel and help other people, right?
Yeah.
I was thinking of Hebrews 4:12. The word of God is quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. But now notice verse 14 of Ephesians 2. He is our peace, who hath made both one, hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and hath he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. Folks, Jew and Gentile are in the kingdom. I like that parable that Jesus spoke of, that the kingdom of heaven is like a net, and it gathers of every kind.
Mm.
Jew and Gentile both are in the kingdom that Jesus announced. I want to ask you this question, Christian. Because a lot of people look at the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, and they see the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Remember that prayer?
Mm.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Well, part of that prayer has the phrase, thy kingdom come.
Mm.
But why is it that we don't pray that prayer anymore?
The kingdom has already come.
The kingdom has already come.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've heard people out of the church, and I'll be honest with you, even a few in, they get confused and say, well, we can still pray the kingdom to come because of this and that. But really, the true teaching of that is the kingdom has already come.
Amen.
We understand we want the kingdom to continue to expand, but I'm talking about the simplicity of that statement. The kingdom came in Acts 2, right? The fulfillment of Isaiah 2.
Amen.
So tell us a few things about, I don't know where you're going, unless you're going somewhere different.
I didn't want to get off topic, but I was even thinking, you know, the kingdom being here, I was even thinking with John and Revelation chapter 1, verse 9.
Yeah, go ahead.
Even makes the reference that I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom in patience of Jesus Christ. He was in the kingdom. He was that companion of us. And so...
Now that's interesting because depending upon the date you take, some take it as early as 68, 69 A.D., some as late as A.D. 96, but everyone less than 100 A.D. So before 100 A.D., John, the apostle, says he was in the kingdom. Well, we wouldn't pray for something to come that's already come.
Right.
Now, the reason, of course, Jesus mentions that prayer in the model prayer is because at that time the kingdom had not come. But it's coming. In fact, Jesus said he's going to build his church, Matthew 16, 18, and he's going to turn right around, verse 19, and give the keys of the kingdom to Peter so that Peter can stand up on the day of Pentecost and preach. So let's keep reading in Isaiah here, because as we keep reading this, all my mind is seeing right now is Acts 2. This passage in prophecy is immediately connecting in my mind to Acts 2, and we'll go there before we close the broadcast, obviously.
So in verse 5 of Isaiah 2, O house of Jacob, come ye, and let us walk in the light of the Lord. Verse 6, therefore their house forsaken thy people, the house of Jacob, because they be replenished from the east, and are soothsayers like the Philistines, and they please themselves in the children of strangers.
Well, how are we going to walk in the light of the Lord? He says to the house of Jacob, the Israelites, they're going to have and receive this prophecy. In fact, Jesus says the gospel is going to go to them first. The Israelites are going to have an opportunity to hear and to obey the truth before anybody else. That's Acts, the second chapter. If you want to turn over there, and we'll start in those passages. But he says, come and let us walk in the light of the Lord. Well, folks, the light of the Lord is a reflection of his divine path and prophecies and what those prophecies lead us to. So tonight, here's what I want to get down to so we can really start wrapping some things up here. If you are watching this broadcast, I want to ask a very personal question. Number one, are you in the kingdom of God? Now, I'm not talking about some physical kingdom that supposedly Jesus someday is going to come back and rule from Jerusalem on the throne of David and all this stuff. Because honestly, that is not in the text. There's not a passage in the New Testament that teaches that. Now, we're not trying to be unkind, but we've got to teach here so that you can understand what we're saying. Because sometimes I've learned this, Christian, you can think we've made it simple, but then people have heard it all their lives one way and they'll get off and they'll give two thumbs up, but we're still completely different in what we're saying. So I want to make sure people understand what we've taken the time to say tonight is the kingdom is spiritual. It's within you, but it cannot be within you unless you have already entered into the kingdom. Okay? Not a physical kingdom, John 18, 36. Not a kingdom in the future, because Jesus has already said in Mark chapter 9, verse 1, verily, verily, I say unto you, some of you, because Judas would not make it. He would die. He'd kill himself. Some of you standing here shall not taste of death. Well, we don't have any apostles alive. We don't have any people alive from the first century. So we know that whatever the kingdom was that Jesus promised in Mark 9:1 is the kingdom that's already in vogue. It's already here. It's already in existence. It was established. So when we go to Acts 2, a lot of talk about the kingdom again. Why? Because you have to have a king. You have to have citizens. You have to have a decree. Jesus has just been, he has just made his ascension into the heavens in Acts 1. His coronation takes place. He's crowned King of Kings. He sits down at the right hand of the Father. Now we have a king. Immediately the next chapter is what?
Establishment of his kingdom.
The establishment of the kingdom. You have king in Acts 1. You have Acts 2. You have absolutely the pronouncement and the establishment of the kingdom. Kingdom. And in verse 41, you have the first citizens. Acts 2:41, and they that gladly received his word. What did Isaiah 2 say? They have to, O Jacob, walk in the light of the Lord. To walk in his light is to walk in his decrees, in his law. What was the law? Remember Jesus said to Peter, you're going to be given the keys of the kingdom. What did Peter just preach?
Preach the first gospel sermon.
And what was his summation? What did he tell the people they had to do to be saved?
Well, we'll go right down to it in Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. And Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins.
And isn't that interesting, y'all? We started this on the last episode about the kingdom that Jesus and John preached again, just over and over again. Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. You can't enter into the kingdom as the same person. There has to be a change of state. That's why they were translated, Colossians 1:13, into the kingdom of his dear son. Repentance is a necessary doctrine to be understood and lived out initially and ongoing. So Peter says the same thing that Jesus said, same thing that John said, repent and be baptized. Now, by the way, to have that changed state, you have to desire it. You have to agree to that changed state. But you cannot change yourself by yourself completely.
No.
So that's where baptism comes in, folks. Baptism, actually, you're not doing the work. Repentance, you're working hard. I'm going to tell y'all something. There's no harder work than repentance. Repentance is hard work. Baptism is that part where God is doing something for you. You're submitting to it, you're obeying him, but actually he, through the blood of Jesus, Colossians 2:12, is cleaning you up.
He's doing the operating on your heart.
Now do you see how, folks, you can enter into the kingdom? That definition, again, twofold. The rule of God in your heart, that's why you have to be in the kingdom for the kingdom to be in you. But secondly, that's connected to a translated state. You're living in a different world, really, than you were before. You've exited this carnal world. Now you're living in this higher plane, the spiritual place where the redeemed live, the sanctified live. Well, how did you get there? You're taught of the Lord, Isaiah 2. Well, when did it become established? Isaiah 2 says, in the last days, the day of Pentecost, when all nations began to flow into it, and they were taught of the ways. They walk in the light of the Lord. Well, you'll see here in Acts 2, they that gladly received his word, verse 41. What word? The king's decree spoken by Peter, the keys of the kingdom. Peter said, repent and be baptized. How many of us?
3,000.
Yeah. How many of us are supposed to obey the gospel?
Well, all men.
All men. Mm-hmm. But folks, only 3,000 obeyed. Now, in our generation, all men can come into the kingdom, Jew or Gentile. Doesn't matter who you are, man or woman, as long as you're responsible and have your faculties. You're of an age. But there's so many people that will dance around this text. Y'all know you shouldn't be dancing. Dancing around this text that hop and skip and go anywhere under the sun. But if we just look at the text itself and we just did what Peter asked them to do, repent and be baptized. Repentance, again, is a change of disposition. It starts in the heart. It's an acknowledgement of our place. It's godly sorrow. It demands a change. It has fruits worthy connected to it, John the Baptizer said. It's something that really ought to be a life-altering process.
Amen. And I was even thinking Luke 13:3, unless you repent, ye shall likewise perish. I think of the sinner state before we are cleansed. We're perishing, we're withering away, we're dying. And so this baptism, it rejuvenates us, our spiritual lives. And I'm not talking physically, I'm talking about spiritually. It'll cleanse us, it adds to the kingdom, adds to the church, Acts 2:47, no doubt. But it rejuvenates us. We have that kingdom within us. You know, I think about Romans 1:9, talks a little bit about having that kingdom and having God within us because we've been added to the church. We've been added to the kingdom, Acts 2.
And that's why so many people are confused because, and I don't mean just religiously confused. I don't mean that. I'm talking about confused in their life. They lack purpose and they're people that no doubt have good desires and they have, a lot of good thoughts and they're trying to do good, but you just don't realize the blessings, Ephesians 1:3, that you could have if you would just come on and repent and come into the kingdom.
Amen.
There's an advantage and a purpose of life that's indescribable until you enter into the kingdom. And that question that Nicodemus asked to Jesus in John 3 is answered in Acts 2:38. Repent and be baptized. For what reason? The remission of sin. So that you can have the remission of sins. You're not saved at repentance. You're not saved at belief. You're saved when God says we're saved, and we're saved when we contact the blood of Jesus. And Romans 6 says that blood is located in one place, in the death of Jesus Christ, John 19:34. Remember that Roman soldier took a spear and pierced his side?
Yes.
Forthwith there came out?
Blood and water.
Blood and water. And it's interesting, folks, it takes two things tonight to save a person, two elements, blood and water. I've heard many people debate the washing away of sin in Acts 22:16. Is it the blood or is it the water? Well, let me just say it this way. You can't be saved without both.
That's right.
You take away the water, what's the blood going to do? Because God placed the blood alongside the water. It's the blood that removes the sin, the stain of the sin, but it's the water that does the washing. I remember an old preacher, Marshall Keeble, said it like this years ago. He said he told his, you know, that's when washing machines first came out. Mm. You know, before, people didn't have that luxury, Christian.
No.
You don't remember that. You don't go back as far as I do. Yeah. No, I'm not that old. Mm-hmm. But y'all know, but seriously, before, when Marshall Keeble said when he got his washing machine, that he and his wife was having this little chat, and he was making a Bible teaching here. He would, you know, preachers use things to make a point. And he said he saw his wife take an old shirt. It was pretty stained, and she threw that stained shirt in the washing machine, and she added some dash. That's back before Tide, they called it dash. She added some dash. He said, but now if she'd have added that dash and never turned that water on, what would have happened?
Nothing.
The dash has the power to remove the stain, but you add the water to it, and the water does the agitating or the washing. So in our lives, the blood of Jesus is the soul cleansing agent. Amen. To remove the burden of sin and that nasty stain. But according to the scripture, it's in the baptism, in the watery grave, that that takes place. And then I think about John 19:34. There's two elements that came from the side of Jesus. It wasn't just blood, Christian. It was blood and water. Water's always been in God's plan. And if we submit to him, really it's not about merely the water. It's about obedience. Mm. But if you obey, that includes water. And I just thought about that tonight to kind of tie all that in.
Sure.
What are some concluding thoughts that you have? I mean, what could we do teaching-wise to help make it plainer for people to come to Christ?
Well, what's interesting is you said something that, you know, let the word, let God tells what saves us. Because we know that repentance alone does not save. We have to repent, but alone does not save.
Right.
Belief alone does not save. We have to believe. And so I'm not trying to discount those things. But what's interesting is, think about in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 21. It says, the likewise figure whereunto baptism doth now save us. Not a removal of the filth of the flesh, not the physical flesh, but an answer of a good conscience towards God unto Jesus Christ. And so we talk so much highly about baptism, but it's not necessarily that we're, you know, want to physically get cleansed. We're trying to clean out our heart, that all those sins being remissed, Acts 2:38. And so talking about how do we get people to see that? I mean, you have to put all of these points together. Yes. You've got to have a good understanding of the Old Testament prophecy, which points to the day of Pentecost, right? The establishment of the kingdom of the church. And I know we reiterated these points a million times, but we want our viewers to know repetition is key. And that's how it helps me try to study with somebody, because it has to,
sure,
to repeat. You have to study. You have to repeat. Even if you read Acts 2:38 and Isaiah 2 and Joel chapter 2, verses 28 through 32, if you'd read those 100 times.
And even for a person that's already a Christian, to
right,
keep going over that, it reinforces the confidence.
Amen. And so it builds up a confidence, and it builds up your ability to help prick, you know, not you yourself, but the word prick the heart of somebody you're studying with. I think about the Jews, their hearts were pricked, Acts 2:37. So that's what led them to, you know, 3,000 of them to repent and be baptized. And so I think repetition is a big key here. And I know that repetition takes time, takes effort, it takes dedication. I know sometimes that we can get bogged down with life, and I know that we can get maybe discouraged,
sure,
by outside influences and, you know, bad communications, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 33. But we have to remember to study to show thyself approved unto God, 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly divine the word of truth. And so, like I said, my answer is simple, but at the same time, it's just repetition, it's key, it's studying, it's edifying one another.
And don't be afraid. I know I had to deal with this years ago when I was younger. Don't be afraid to let God lead you in the word of God. That's how he leads us. But sometimes we resist that. Some people are kind of more interested, well, I think God wants me to do this or that. Well, you don't have to think in that sense,
right,
in the sense of wondering. You can know what God wants you to do. When it comes to salvation, there's some things in the Bible, admittedly, that are difficult to understand. Even Peter makes that remark about Paul's writings.
Right.
But when it comes to how we are saved, salvation, those things are not really difficult. They're spelled out very simply because God wants men to be saved. He didn't complicate it. What's happened is people have complicated
Amen.
It. So you want to go to heaven? I know this. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 24, then cometh the end, when Jesus Christ shall deliver the kingdom over to his Father. What kingdom? The kingdom he promised to establish and give Peter the keys to, Matthew 16:19. The same kingdom, he says, not of this world, John 18:36. The same kingdom that you and I are able to enter in, just as he told Nicodemus how to enter in John 3. It's the same spiritual kingdom that, again, at the end of time, Jesus is going to turn over to his Holy Father. That's the church. That's the body of Christ. Amen. That's the saved. That's the people that are ready to leave this earth. Well, how do I enter into the kingdom? You enter into the kingdom through just exactly what Peter told those Jewish people to do on the day of Pentecost. They already believed. They asked the question, what must we do? Peter said, repent. Remember that changed state and be baptized. Interestingly enough, people talk about, you know, well, baptism can't be a part of salvation because it's a work. Well, it's a work, but it's a work of God, Colossians 2:12. But they'll tell people to pray. Well, praying is a lot of work. Sometimes when I'm really into praying extensively for a while, praying is emotionally will take a toll on you in a good way.
Right.
It causes you to strike a balance of humility in your life. Mm-hmm. It causes you to focus upon things that sometimes you don't really want to focus about, you know, where you're spiritually lacking and you ask for divine assistance in those areas. So prayer is a lot of work. Interestingly enough, the only portion of the things we discussed tonight, I mean, it takes a lot of work to believe when you think about evidence. It takes a lot of work to repent, start changing your life. The one aspect that really does not involve human work is baptism. Mm-hmm. If I asked you to baptize me tonight, of course, I don't need to. I've already been baptized.
Sure.
But just by way of, I'm asking you to baptize me. You don't baptize yourself.
No.
Somebody else baptizes you physically.
Sure.
Well, in the watery grave of baptism, who's doing the work on me? I'm standing in need of the grace of God, and God, through the blood of Christ, is doing the work for me. And so I want everybody to understand, yes, you have to obey the Lord in baptism. But it's the beauty and the wondrous work of Calvary's cross in the heart of the person that stands in need in this moment.
Amen.
So we want to implore you to think about entering into the kingdom. Think about becoming a member of this of the church. Think about having your sins washed away. Think about salvation. We would ask that you share this on your page so that other people that are not in the kingdom can hear this message. This is why we're doing this. Undoubtedly, these lessons are very fundamental. Mm. If you're in the Church of Christ and you're watching this program every two or three times a week, we want you to know the reason we are going over these very fundamental truths, not only to provide confidence to you in that what you did was obedience to the truth, but mainly to reach out to those who you love, your friends, your neighbors, and to teach them the gospel. Remember Isaiah 2, that the gospel is a taught message. And the house of Jacob had to be taught, the Israelites, concerning the truth, and so do the Gentiles today. Come into the kingdom. John was in the kingdom, Revelation 1:9. Are you in the kingdom? As we close this evening, Christian, any last thought that you have before we kind of dismiss?
Well, I was even thinking what you said. I agree with that 100%. We're not here to, you know, try to popularize or even sell the word of God, Proverbs 23:23. We're trying to do our very best to go thee therefore into all nations, to everywhere we can, and preach the gospel, preach the truth, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth, John 17:17. And it really comes out of a stem of love. I was thinking 1 John 4, verse 8 says, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love.
God is love.
And we love you.
If you had a cure, just thought about this. If you had a cure right now for COVID-19 and you did not tell people about the cure, what would that say?
I didn't love them.
The Bible gives us the cure for man's sin, much more important than the cure for COVID-19.
Amen.
Sin needs to be cured. The only one that can cure it is Jesus. Folks, we thank you for joining in tonight. Hope and pray that your week is a good one. But in every single day, all of us ought to be asking this very The very same question. What saith the scriptures?